I am, as you guys know, kind of a sports fan. I have a lot of fun with different things, and I officiate several different sports. And, you know, I'm always amazed at the unselfishness that goes on in sports sometimes, just the whole practice of certain things. In the fall, I do volleyball, and there's a player that's designated. They call him the libero. They wear a different color jersey even. But they never really get to play offensively. They're just all completely defense. They never get to go up in the front row and actually hit the ball, you know, over the net or spike it or anything like that. They are not even allowed to stay in a full rotation. They can only rotate in the back row. And just that, the unselfishness of that person willing to just only play defense and never score a point really or anything like that is kind of amazing to me. I think of the same in baseball when they ask a player to sacrifice bunt or sacrifice fly or things like that. I think of amazing to me as a pitcher, sometimes we'll see somebody warming up in the bullpen because they're struggling and they're hurting. They seem to get a little bit more effective when they know somebody's coming in to replace them. There's sometimes that selfish side of the sport as well, that I don't want to give up the ball. I don't want somebody else to come in and to do my job. I know when Sterling played football in high school, he was a lineman. And, you know, he blocked for people and just gave up himself and his body. And, you know, you don't ever hear anybody wanting to glamorize that position very much. You know, when you have, like we did fantasy football, there is no opportunity to pick a lineman. It's not a fantasy position that anybody wants to be a part of. But yet those guys, man, they fall on the ground, they roll on the ground, they give up their body so that the quarterback or the running back or the receiver can get the spotlight. And so as we talk about serving, there's a lot of things like that are amazing to me. One of the things that I'm always amazed at when I officiate basketball, like this week, when a guy's at the free throw line and he's shooting a free throw, there'll be sometimes a substitute waiting over there. They'll sound the horn and I'll go, you know, I'll say sub in. They go, no, he's for the shooter. And I'm thinking to myself all the time, well, if I'm at the free throw line and I know there's a guy waiting to replace me, if I make that free throw, I'm probably going to miss that free throw every time, because then the game keeps going and nobody comes in. But there's that unselfish nature of a lot of players that they'll focus, they'll make that free throw, even knowing that if they make it, somebody's coming in to replace me. And this is really the mentality of a servant, that we have to understand that everything that we do is a team effort, that we have to work together. And it's not always the most glamorous thing to serve, that serving God is not about the limelight. It's not about a title. It's not about a position. It's not about the spotlight. But it's about a mission. It's about leading people to Christ. It's about changing our world. And sometimes it's all about sacrifice. And you've got to give up your own selfish desires or your own feelings or your own position or your own place or popularity or fame or fortune or those types of things. And you know, Jesus knew that his days on the earth were short. His mission wasn't only to change the world, but he knew that at 30, 33 years of age, his ministry would be over. And so in a few short years, his goal was to build a system that would perpetually be touching the world and changing the world. The Bible says that he didn't consider equality with God something to be held on to, something to be grasped. But he laid aside his reputation, his mighty power and glory, and came to this earth as a human being. And so there was a great sacrifice involved. And his goal was to build an army of servants, to build a body, to build a network of people, to build a movement of people that would be changing the world. In his mind, he did not mind setting aside his position to come to this earth to serve. And that's what he said. I didn't come to be served, but I came to serve. And I came to give my life a ransom for many. I'm always amazed at that statement, because I begin to think to myself what the church in the United States would look like if everybody took on that mentality. But unfortunately, so many people, they come to a church not with the attitude of, I'm not here to be served, I'm here to serve and to give. But so many people walk in with, what do you have to offer me? Serve me. What things do you have for me? Not what do I have to serve you? You know the famous JFK quote, ask not what you can do for your church. I'm sorry, what your church can do for you, but ask what you can do for your church or for God's kingdom. But, you know, we live in a different mentality, in a different age, where what is in it for me is the mentality. Look here in Mark chapter 6. I'm excited about this story of the feeding of the 5,000 and how it relates to our topic this morning of serving. It says in verse 35, we're going to read down through the 44th verse. It says, when the day was now far spent, his disciples came to him and said, this is a deserted place, and already the hour is late. Send the people away that they might go into the surrounding country and villages and buy themselves bread, for they have nothing to eat. Again, Jesus had been teaching a crowd of people on a hillside all day long, out in the wilderness, out in the middle of nowhere, and this is what the disciples say. But it says, Jesus answered and said to them, you give them something to eat. And they said, Lord, shall we go and buy 200 denarii worth of bread and give them something to eat? But he said to them, how many loaves do you have? Go and see. When they found out, they said, 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he commanded them to make them all sit down in groups on the green grass. And they sat down in ranks, in hundreds and fifties. And when he had taken the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to his disciples to set before the people. And the 2 fish he divided among them all. So they all ate and were filled, and they took up 12 baskets full of fragments and of the fish they had leftovers. Isn't it always good to have leftovers? So we have an interesting story, and I know many of you have heard this many times, but again, Jesus is out, he's preaching, it's probably a crowd, and you know the count, they usually only counted the men, it said 5,000 men, which means there were probably maybe 10,000 people there if you counted women and children, and the disciples say, Lord, you know, I imagine these guys, the disciples, were hungry. And so they're kind of trying to put it off on the people. Lord, these people got to be hungry. Why don't we send them away into some of the neighboring towns to get some food? And Jesus turns the tables on these guys and turns the whole situation around. The first point I want to make in your outline this morning, servants own the burdens of others. Jesus says, you give them food. Amen? You know, we have a dynamic, I think it happens in pretty much any company, but also in churches, where a lot of people, they come up with these grand schemes, these grand ideas, these great plans, and they always want to bring it to somebody else and hand it to them and say, we need to do this. And when they say we, they mean the person they're talking to needs right to do this, right? And that's what the disciples are doing to Jesus. These people are hungry. We need to send them away and go get them some food. And Jesus turns it right back around and says, wait, we've got an issue here. We've got a problem. We've got a burden. Now, you take some responsibility in this. You take some ownership of this situation. And see, this is what God expects of us as a church when it comes to the mission of Jesus Christ, when it comes to the building of the church, when it comes to the reaching of people that are hurting, when it comes to helping the poor and needy, when it comes to building the kingdom of God. You know, everybody wants, they've got grand ideas of what the church needs to do. The church needs to do this, and the church needs to do this, and we need to do. May I remind you that you are the church. Amen? I have it happen all the time. People come up to me and they have great ideas and great plans, and Pastor, we need to do this. And I say, you know, that's a great idea. Do me a favor. Take some time and write out your plan, what you think needs to happen, who you think can be involved, how we're going to resource it, what the schedule looks like, and how to facilitate it. Give me all the logistics of it, and come back, and we'll sit down, and I'll help you to be able to facilitate this plan. Well, what I'm doing is I'm putting it back on them. And you know what? I think there's only been one time that somebody's ever come back to me with a plan. Because what they wanted was not for them to do anything. They wanted me to do it. And see, that's what the disciples are doing to Jesus here. Lord, send these people away. Somebody else needs to feed them. Somebody else needs to take care of them. And I said it a couple weeks ago. I've been in ministry 30 years. I've never met somebody else. This person that everybody expects to do things all the time. Because we live in a consumer mentality. We live in a consumerism type culture in our world today, where somebody else is going to give, somebody else is going to serve. I'm here for what you can do for me. And this is not the way the body of Christ is designed to operate. And you know, one of the things I'm learning about this millennial generation that God is raising up, they love to serve. They love to be involved. They love to have a reason to be here. They love to get involved. And I want to challenge you, if you're part of that generation, we have places that we want to plug you into. We want you to be involved. We need your help. In Galatians chapter 6 and verse 2, it says to bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. This is the law of Christ. These people had a burden. They were hungry. And Jesus says, let's bear their burden. This is how you fulfill the law of Christ. And so this method of sending people away is not what God wants us to do. God shows you needs so that you can employ your gift to meet the needs. God has given you a gift and he shows you a need. There's a reason for that, because he has equipped you and gifted you to help to facilitate the need of that person. That's not something that people get real excited about. Say, amen, pastor. But that is a good spot for an amen right there. There's needs all over our world. And we like to complain about them. We like to talk about them. We like to identify them. We like to talk about what needs to happen. And we've got all kind of great ideas. But you ever think that maybe you're the answer to that problem, to that situation? And this is what Jesus does to the disciples. Number two, you are God's answer. You are an answer to whatever it is that God is showing you. God has put you in a place and revealed that need to you, a need that maybe nobody else saw, because he wants you to help to fill that need. He wants you to help to be an answer to that situation. And if you don't step forward, sometimes you're not the answer, you become part of the problem. I tell people this all the time. To identify a problem without wanting to be part of the solution is just complaining. Amen, pastor. And if all you're doing is complaining, now you're just being part of the problem. I want to be part of the solution. I don't want to be part of the problem. So Jesus tells the disciples here to feed the people. And they start making excuses as to why they can't. Lord, you know how much money that would cost to feed all of these people? Should we take 200 denarii and go buy bread for these people to give them something to eat? And I'm sure in their mind they're thinking, you know, there's 10,000 people here. Did you ever try to feed 10,000 people? There's 12 disciples. But how many of you know God knows how to do everything? Amen? Jesus begins to show them what to do. They tell Jesus the cost would be too great. And you know, this is where so many people fall short of God's plan for their life. The Bible talks about counting the cost. And the disciples here, they begin to count the cost. And the cost is far greater than what they have. But the cost of doing something for God is never far greater than God's resources. God has the resources. He is just looking for you to be willing to be used by him. He will provide the resources. Sometimes we are overwhelmed by the cost of things, and many people miss out on a blessing when you focus on what you don't have, what you can't do. You can do all things through Christ who gives you strength. Amen? That's what the Bible teaches us. And so stop focusing on what you don't have. Stop focusing on what you can't do, because you'll never accomplish anything for God if that's your mentality, if that's what you're looking at. And so it almost seems like Jesus gets frustrated here with the disciples. And he looks at them, he says, look, stop focusing on what you don't have. And he asks them, he says, what do you have? What do you have? See, this is one of the greatest challenges for most people, is we have in our mind rehearsed a list of what we lack, what we don't have, what our problems are, what all the negative things in our life. And we recite this over and over and over and over and over and over again in our mind. And we never stop to take inventory of what we do have, what our blessings are, what God has given to us. And so Jesus says, what do you have? Because if you put it in the hands of God, you'll be amazed at what God can do with what you do have. I'm reminded of the little widow woman in the Old Testament that Elijah asked her for something to eat. And she says, I just got enough to make one more meal. And I was going to make that meal for my son and I, and we were both going to die. What a sad picture she painted there. I think if I was Elijah, I would have said, let me go out. I'll buy you some groceries. I'll get you some food. Did he say that? No. He said, make that meal and give me something to eat first. I would have looked at him and said, sir, get out of here. I can't. Yeah, how selfish can you be? But see, when you take things and you put them in the hands of God, amazing things happen. Amazing things happen. when you're willing to give things away. And I shared about this when we were talking about giving, but every successful person, every millionaire, every financial seminar you go to, they will teach you that if you want more money to flow into your life, you have to be willing to give some away and release things to a charitable cause, to a mission, to something positive. And this is a biblical principle. What you sow, you will reap. And so Jesus says, what do you have? I believe that you already have what you need to serve God in the areas that God is asking you to serve. You just don't dwell on it. You dwell on what you don't have. God is asking you to do something because you have within you the ability, the inherent ability to do what God is asking you to do. You may not have every resource at the moment, but that's not the way God works. Remember when he called Abraham, he says, I want you to go to a land that I will show you. Did God show the path how to get there, the journey? Did he provide all the information that Abraham needed before he started the journey? No. But as Abraham was faithful to obey God and take that first step, God began to provide everything that he needed. By the time he got to that promised land, he was so filthy rich, it wasn't big enough for him and his nephew both. But if Abraham would have sat back in Ur of the Chaldees and said, you know, I'm going to sit here, God, until you show me everything. I'm not taking that step. I'm not serving you. I'm not stepping out in you until I have everything that I need to do it. Just think of the blessing he would have missed out on. Just think of all the things that God wanted to do in him and through him that would have never happened. And so oftentimes God shows you a need, and you don't realize that if you step out and begin to pursue the meeting of that need, the serving of that need, God will resource you with everything that you need to be able to accomplish what he's shown you, what he's calling you to do. He showed the disciples hungry people. And he says, you meet that need. Don't push it off on somebody else. You meet that need. And this is part of serving God. He will show you areas that you can serve in, places where there are great needs, where you can help. And you have to sometimes believe God for the ability. The cost might seem great. And let me tell you something. God will often show you things that he wants you to do where the cost is far greater than what you have, than what you think you have. Because God is not looking for you to do things in your might, your strength, your ability. God is looking for you to live by faith. God is looking for you to trust him. God is looking for you to find opportunities that will drive you to your knees in prayer so that you will have a deeper relationship with God, a greater understanding of God, so that there will be more opportunities for him to move in your life. See, the problem is when we see things, we see problems, but God sees potential where there are problems. He sees possibilities where there are problems. And this is the mentality that we need to have, that we need to begin to step out and trust God, that if God shows you a need, there's a good chance that he wants you to meet that need. And if you begin to look at what you lack, you'll miss out on a great blessing from God. God asks us to use what we have to do things that are far beyond our resources. And don't allow what you lack to keep you from serving. Jesus tells the disciples here to begin to prepare the people for a feast. Tell them to sit down in groups of hundreds and fifties. Let's get ready for a meal. I don't know about you, but if I'm a disciple, Jesus said, how much do you got? I said, I got 5 loaves and 2 fish. All right, have the people sit down. Have the what, Lord? Did you see how many people are out here? There are 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, Lord. There are close to 10,000 people out here, God. You don't see that conversation. The disciples begin to obey Jesus. They begin to do what Jesus told them to do. See, if you want to see miracles happening in your life, you have to obey Jesus when it doesn't make sense to obey him. Amen. You have to step out and begin to prepare for that miracle. If you want to see miracles, you've got to prepare for miracles. And so the disciples begin to ask the people to sit down in groups of 50s or hundreds. And the people are saying, oh, you're going to feed us. And the disciples say, I don't know, but the Lord's going to do something. Like the story we talked about last week with a Jonathan and his armor bearer. Perhaps the Lord will act on our behalf. Let's prepare for a miracle. Let's do something that will create an environment for God to move. Jonathan and his armor bearer had been sitting there watching Saul cower in fear of the Philistines for so long. And he said, God's not going to move in this environment of fear. God's not going to move by us just sitting here doing nothing. There is a cause. There is a problem. There is a need. Let's begin to prepare. Let's begin to create an environment where God can move and do a miracle to meet this need. And see, that's what we need to do. We need to create environments for God to move. And God moves in an environment of faith. And when you look at the lack of your resources, you're not operating in faith. But when you begin to step out trusting that God will make up the difference, that God will bring the resources, now you have created an environment of faith for God to move. And you know, God takes it even a step further in this story, and I love this story. But when you're willing to serve God in faith, prepare for a miracle.
And Pastor, I don't see any miracles happening in my life.
It's because you're not doing anything for God. You're not stepping out and trusting God. You're wallowing in your lack and your self-pity and what you don't have. And why does this one got this and that one got that? Because they began to step out in faith. That was my Droopy impression. Hey, you remember that cartoon character, Droopy?
Droopy, yeah.
I watched too many cartoons growing up. But that's our mentality sometimes. We focus on what's not happening. That's not an atmosphere of faith. That's not an atmosphere for God to move. What they did was they took inventory of what they did have and they put it in the hands of Jesus, knowing that what they had was never going to feed 10,000 people. But when I put it in the hands of Jesus, watch what will happen. Watch what will happen. You may not, you know, we talk about a lot of things around the church here, a lot of opportunities for you to get involved, to help, to give, and you may just sit there going, well, that's not for me. Well, I can't do that. Well, that's not. Stop looking at what you can't do. Start saying, you know what, God, I'm going to put that in your hands, and I'm going to believe that I can do all things through Christ, that I can get involved in that area. You know, there's times where we'll ask people to help in certain areas, or we'll help ask people to get involved or to step up and fill some void in the church. And there's so many people that they just don't step up because they think, I can't do that. Now, don't get me wrong. As we're talking about serving, you want to find something that God has gifted you in so that you'll be fulfilled in your serving. Go back and listen to the last couple of weeks, but that's important. We want you to be fulfilled and not frustrated. But at the same time, we don't want you to be idle either. We don't want you to just sit and complain about your lack of resources. What do you have? What do you have? I think of Moses taking that staff that God gave him and being willing to lay it down. You know, God called Moses to lead, to be a deliverer for the Israelites in bondage in Egypt. And Moses began to say, well, God, I got a speech impediment. I stutter. What? How can I help these people? God says, what's in your hand? What's in your hand? And that's what he's asking you today. What's in your hand? That's what he asked the disciples. What's in your hand? What do you have? Moses said, a staff. God said, just lay it down. Throw it down before me. See, because Moses' staff was his identity. He was a shepherd. He was out watching Jethro's sheep on the backside of the desert. And his whole life had gotten wrapped up in something that caused him to not see that God wanted him to serve as a deliverer. God wanted him to be able to deliver the Israelites. But he took all these gifts and he was using them for a different purpose. Amen? You know, sometimes In your employment, in doing something, you'll figure out, you know what, God has gifted me in this area, but I'm not using it for his kingdom and for his glory. I'm using it for my own fulfillment. And God said to Moses, you know, that thing I've given you to be a shepherd is a leadership gift. Stop using it for Jethro's sheep and lay it down before me. And as he threw it down before the Lord, you know, the story transformed. It changed into a serpent. It scared Moses. And you know what? The things that God asked you to lay down before him and give up, for his glory sometimes will scare you. Moses ran from it. There's a lot of people that are running from what God has called them to do or asked them to do. Finally, Moses accepted that challenge. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad that he did? You have something in your hand, and you're using it for some purpose. Why not use it for the glory of God? Put it in the hands of God and watch what God can do with it. They put their resources in the hands of Jesus. And Jesus takes it and blesses it and multiplies it, lifts it up to God. And then what does he do? He gives it back to them. Doesn't he? This is the awesome part about God and his kingdom. When you give to God, you can expect it to come back. He will bless it. He will multiply it. He will transform it. And he will give it back to you. See, we have this mentality. We hate to give up anything. We hate to release anything. Because we don't trust it. God will always give it back to us. God gives back to you what you release to him. Amen? You have to be willing to let go. If you want to go up in God's kingdom, you've got to be willing to let go. So Jesus could have taken that lunch and multiplied it in his own hands and fed the people. He could have said, give me the bread, let me feed the people. But God has chosen to do his incredible work through you, through his disciples, through people. We often pray for God to move and God to do something as if we're just going to sit here and wait for God to appear in a burning bush or speak through a donkey or flow water out of a rock like he has in the past. And he can do those things. But he chooses to put his resources back in the hands of people and allow you to be the answer to somebody's need, to allow you to be the answer to some problem and situation. And so Jesus takes it and he gives it back to the disciples. God wants to do miracles through you so that you can be excited about watching a miracle happen before your very eyes. God wants you to experience miracles. And he wants to do them through you. It's a great thing to see a miracle. But it's an even greater experience to have you be the facilitator, the conduit through which God does a miracle. I tell you what, I've had that experience in my life a few times. I've heard testimonies. I've seen miracles. I've seen people healed. But when you're the one that God uses to flow through to meet another person's need, wow, it just excites you. It just makes you want to serve God even that much more. Amen. So this is what Jesus does. He blesses the bread. There's still 5 loaves. There's still 2 fish. And he gives it to the disciples. And I don't know how he did it. There was 12 disciples. He must have broke some of the bread in half and handed it to them. So now each of them have less than a half a loaf of bread. And there's groups of hundreds and fifties. And he says, now go give to the people. I don't know, man. I think I would have walked over to a group of 50 and said, here, you guys figure it out. But no, it says somewhere I read that bread multiplied in the hands of the disciples. That as they broke off a piece and handed it to a person, they looked back and there was more there. And they broke off and they did this thousands of times, hundreds of times. And they watched this thing just grow and multiply. And as they gave away, they looked back and they had more there. This is the way God works. It doesn't make sense to us. God, I need finances. We'll give some away. No. You didn't hear me. I need it. Give it away. Because when you do, you look back and you'll have more there. That's the way God works. And so as they did this, they handed it to people. And it multiplied in their hands. Now, I don't know. I'm just being real this morning. I think the disciples wanted to send the people away because they were hungry. And I got 5 loaves and 2 fish, and there's 10,000 people out here. I think, hey, fellas, let's huddle up. Now, listen, I'm starving. I don't know about you. But if we give to these 10,000 people, we ain't going to have anything to eat. Now, let's take a little bit first and give the people the leftovers. And you know, this is the mentality that so many people have. God gets their leftovers of their time, their talent, their energy, their excitement, their finances. God gets the leftovers. But this isn't what the disciples did. They broke and they gave it to the people, and it multiplied, and a great miracle happened. And there were 12, not loaves, basketfuls of leftovers. How many disciples were there? 12. They started with 5 loaves. If you took 5 and gave them to 12 disciples, they wouldn't have had much. They had 12 basketfuls. More left over than what they started with. This is the way God works. If you serve Him, if you decide to do things for God, how many miracles do we miss out on by not serving? We think, I can't afford to because I don't have the time. I can't afford to because I don't have the resource. I can't afford to because I don't have the talent. But if you step out in faith and do it, man, the miracles that'll happen in your life, and you'll have more left over than what you started with. This is the way God works. I found it to be true. I have more time. I have more strength. I have more energy. I have more finances. Sometimes I feel guilty because God has blessed us so much. Because we serve God and we serve His mission and we serve His kingdom. And I know I don't deserve it, but this is the way God works. None of us deserve it. But as you serve Him, He gives you what you don't deserve. Number 5 in your outline, true servants put other people first. And I touched on that just a minute ago. The disciples may have been tempted to eat first because of the lack of food, but when they put other people first, there were 12 basketfuls left over for them to eat. And if you put other people first, God will always meet your needs. And not only will He meet your needs, but you will always have an abundance in your life. You will always have an abundance in your life. But if you have the mentality that I got to look out for number one, that I got to cover my own hiney, that I got to take care of myself, you'll always struggle. You always will. Because self has become your God. But when God is the Lord of your life, He will make sure that you are taken care of. The Bible says, I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed begging bread. Amen? This is the way that God operates. By putting others first and serving them, you actually will have more than what you would have by serving yourself. Finally, this morning, serving is an issue of the heart. Serving is a heart issue. And so I pray for God to give you the heart of a servant. God wants you to have the heart of a servant. Look what it says here in Colossians chapter 3 and verse 23. It says, work willingly at whatever you do, as though you were working for the Lord rather than for people. Remember that the Lord will give you an inheritance as your reward, and that the master you are serving is Christ. Amen? Another translation says, do it heartily as unto the Lord. Do it heartily. In other words, serving is something you don't do with your strength or with your might. You serve with your heart. You serve with your heart. And if you're not serving, then there's an issue with your heart. There's something wrong with your heart. And you have to pray and say, God, is there something I need to change? Is there a motive that's wrong on the inside of my heart? Because God, His heart is to serve. That's why Jesus came to this earth, was to serve. The heart of Christ is to serve. And don't mistake what I'm saying this morning. I'm not looking to burn people out. And this is one of the problems in the body of Christ. Because there is a lack of people with a heart to serve, the burden gets put on so few shoulders that people get burned out. I have made a commitment in the 22 years I've been pastoring our church, because I was a part of a church like this in the past, that somebody had come into the church and they were excited and they were gifted, and I watched the church just suck the life out of them. Everything that there was a need, that person was the answer. Call that person. They're willing. They got energy. They got might. They'll do it. I don't want to do that. I want every one of you to catch the vision for serving and being involved, so that great burden is not too heavy upon one person's shoulders that we burn people out. That's not God's plan. That's not God's design. but that all of us, and we'll talk about this next week, we are part of a body. All of us have a part to play, and every one of us is important. Ecclesiastes chapter 9 and verse 10 says, whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all of your might. See, the challenge with human nature is that we don't tend to have a servant mentality. We have a mentality of, we want to have credit. We want to be honored. Jesus didn't have that heart here. He could have very easily said, you know, this ministry thing that I started here a couple years ago is really taking off. And look at the crowds that are showing up for me. Everybody loves me. These people are hungry. Watch what I can do. I can even increase my offerings and my crowds even more by taking this bread and multiplying it and giving it to the people. Jesus didn't do that. He wanted his disciples to be involved. He wanted his disciples to experience the power of God. But so many of us, we want to be the spotlight. We want to be the one that gets the credit. We want to be the one that everybody loves. Jesus was willing to relinquish those things to other people because, again, he was building an army. He was building a body. He was building a movement of people. And so many people, when they do get involved in serving, they don't want to relinquish any of that title, that position, that popularity, because they're insecure, because they love the fact that everybody loves them. But this isn't the way God's church is designed to grow, because God wants us to always be pouring ourselves into other people, always raising up other people. Jesus was not planning to be a permanent fixture to where everything flowed through him. He had 3 years to build up a team that would succeed him, that would replace him. But so many people, they don't want to do that. What do you mean? Work towards somebody replacing me? This is what Jesus did. Train somebody up to be my replacement? Sacrifice myself by bunting the ball? If I got a hit, it would cause my average to go up. Block for somebody else so his name can be in the newspaper? No. Give me the football. I can score a touchdown. See, this is the mentality that we have. But God is building a team. Teamwork is what makes the dream work. But we have this selfish mentality. The heart of the disciples, they embraced correction and feedback. They embraced the Lord asking them questions and telling them, you meet that need. And this is the heart of a servant. It's a heart of humility. It's a heart of teachableness. Self-serving people are addicted to power and position. But we're talking about being a full-service person, not a self-service person. Full-service people don't have these insecurities. They allow others to serve and serve with them. Full-service people don't care who gets the credit as long as the job gets done. Full-service people aren't looking for a title or a position. They're looking for a mission. They're looking to bless people and to change lives. Amen. Are you with me this morning? This is one of the challenges. We have so many people that are threatened by the involvement of others. I don't want others to get involved because they might get credit, or they might be loved more than me, or they might take my spot. This isn't the plan of God. Jesus was thrilled to raise up these 12 men to take his place. That's what a servant does. They raise up people to be fulfilled with what God has called them to do. He was interested in a succession plan. He was training his replacements. Self-serving people will not let go so that others can enjoy the pleasure and provision that comes through serving. You have to be willing to let go and let other people experience the same blessing that you're experiencing, the same miracles that you're experiencing. I know I'm going off in a different vein with this, but God has called us to make disciples. And we become so self-serving and self-centered that we are not reaching other people. We are not teaching other people. We are not discipling other people. We are not training other people. And this is exactly what Jesus is doing in this parable. He's teaching his disciples and training them and showing them that God can work through somebody else. He doesn't always have to work through me. And I'll admit, you know, in my earlier days in ministry, I was insecure. And I'll tell you this, just a little secret. Most pastors are very insecure people. And they like to have that spotlight where you know, everybody loves the pastor. But as you grow further, you realize that that's not going to build a church the way God wants to build a church. That I would love to get to the place when somebody walks in the door of our church and they're new, that they have no clue who is the pastor of the church. Because every one of you is loving them, is discipling people, is teaching. You're all involved. And somebody said, by the way, who's in charge around here? Because we're all working together for the same cause and the same goal. This is the heart of Jesus. He didn't care to be in charge. In fact, if you ever notice, anytime a huge crowd showed up, he was like, get me out of here. Let me get in a boat and go to the other side of the sea. He didn't want the fame. He didn't want the popularity. They tried to give him a title. He says, don't call me that. He wasn't into titles and position and fame. He was into serving people. And this is the heart of Jesus. Finally, this morning, what we need to change in the church is this glorification of leadership. For we have glorified leaders to the point where there is a shortage of those who want to serve. We have glorified leadership. There was a movement in the late 80s and early 90s where, you know, all these books about leadership and seminars about leadership and teaching about leadership came out. And it was necessary to some extent because we had some weak leaders. But we have glorified this concept of leadership so much in the church that nobody wants to serve. Everybody wants to lead. And what happens is we have a lot of people who God has called to serve who are put in places or put themselves in places of leadership, that there's this huge shortage of people that are willing to serve in the church because everybody wants to lead. You've heard of things with more than one head as a freak? Many times the church has 50 heads. Everybody wants to be a head. Nobody wants to be a hand or a foot or a toenail. Well, let me tell you, from somebody who's been a head for many years in my life, I would love to be a toenail. And in fact, a lot of people that get close to see what you do as a pastor, they say, I would never want your job. And I look at them and say, I don't want my job. But that's where God has put us. And the greatest thing that you can do is get behind the vision of another person and help them to fulfill that vision and serve and see a need and fill that need and be a blessing and watch God do miracles in your life. Amen? Let's bow our heads this morning. Father, I thank you for your word today. I thank you, God, for the people that are here just soaking it up and absorbing it, Lord. I pray, Father, that you are raising up an army, a movement of people that are willing to serve, Lord. I know that there are some, Lord, that have been abused in that service. I know there are some that have been hurt over the years, Lord God. I know there are some, Father, that are afraid because of their lack of resources or fear, Lord. God, it's tough sometimes to want to be vulnerable again when you've gone through those situations. I've been there before, Lord. God, I ask you to bring healing to hearts and lives today, Father. I pray, God, for those that maybe they're things are just not in order because of something that has happened and driven them away, Lord. I pray that you would bring them back to a place of finding fulfillment and joy and seeing miracles happening through them in their life, for this is what you've called them to. God, I just sent your Holy Spirit here right now, and I just want to take a moment while heads are bowed and people are praying, Lord. I just ask you to touch hearts right now, Lord God. God, I pray for the healing balm of Gilead, the anointing of God to bring healing, Lord God, where there may be hurts, Father, to bring strength, Lord God, to where there might be fears, Lord. God, to strengthen the faith of people today that have lived in lack for so long, Lord, that they don't realize that they have something to offer, Lord. God, I pray for those, Lord God, that have that staff in their hand and are using it for purposes other than what you've called them to, Lord. that they would have the courage to lay down that rod, that staff today, Lord, and watch what you will do in them and through them, Lord. Father, speak to hearts right now. Speak to hearts, God. We want more of you. We want more of you, Lord. And it comes by giving you more of us, Father. Help us to let go. Help us to let go. Hallelujah. Well, heads are bowed and people are praying. I believe the Lord is speaking to people even now. I just want to ask you today, if you're here and you say, Pastor, I do want more of God, but I realize that before I get more of God, I have to give him more of me. I have to lose my life to find his. And I want you to lead me in a prayer of consecration today, of commitment, to give my life to God today. I'm not talking about somebody that never been a Christian. Maybe you're here this morning and you have been, but you realize you're not where you should be. You just say, Pastor, I want to get to where I need to be. I want to make things right. And I want to see those miracles happening in my life and through me. I want to put, like that little boy put his lunch in the hands of Jesus, I want to put my life in the hands of Jesus today. I want to get back to doing the business of God and being employed in the mission of God's kingdom. I want to serve. I want to serve Jesus. If you're here today and that's you, our heads are bowed, people are praying. We're not here to call you out, point you out, embarrass you, put you on the spot. That's not what we're about this morning. But I do ask you to press through your pride and your courage, your fears this morning, and have the courage, the guts, to just identify with that to God right now. And just say, Pastor, that's me. Just lift your hand up. You can put it right back down. Amen. Hands all over this place. Pastor, that's me. I want to get back to the business of serving God. And for some of you, you know that that was the most fulfilling, enjoyable time of your life. And yes, some things happened, and yes, there was some things that pushed you away. But God is calling you. God is calling you back. I want you to pray this prayer right there at the altar of your seat and mean it from the depth of your heart. Just say, God, I thank you that your hand is upon my life and that you have given me great things. I know that I don't always take inventory of them, but I thank you for your blessings. And this morning, I take what you have given me and I put it in your hands. The greatest gift is my life. I put my life in your hands this morning. I've been using it to serve other purposes. I've been self-serving. I ask you to forgive me. Today I want to serve you. I want to find the fulfillment, the joy, and experience the miracles that only come by serving you. By being willing to obey your voice and to be used by you. There are many things I lack, God, but I won't focus on that. I want to give you what I do have, and I want to use it for your glory and for your honor. And God, I just pray that if there's an issue of my heart, that you would make it right today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah.